Good morning, everyone. So let us begin our understanding today. So we are going to very quickly, you know, revise off with, yes, we are going to very quickly do a revision with your ecology. So we will begin up with our revision on your ecology. All right, everybody. So we will make the understanding onto the different parts of your ecology. So if you are new to me, I am happy to introduce myself. I am Dr. Saranya, and I'm gonna teach you about the different aspects of your ecological concepts. All right. So the first one that we are going to see today, it is about the laws of your ecology. All right, fine. So if you take up with this different laws of your ecology, yes, fine. Yeah, so we are going to mention up with the critical ones, right? So we will begin up with the most critical laws. So before moving into the laws of your ecology, you should understand what is your adaptation and acclimatization, isn't it? Fine. So let us take your advent of your corona, right? So due to the fear of corona, what do? You are getting acclimatized. Okay, so what do? You stay inside your home, isn't it? So it is a permanent one? No, it is going to be a very, very temporary one, isn't it? So once this corona is actually leaving, you will move back into your routine, isn't it? Fine. So that is what you will do whenever this short terms of these things are coming up, right? But if you make up with your adaptation, this adaptation is going to be a permanent one. Okay, but this acclimatization, what I told about your acclimatization, it is going to be your temporary one. Everyone, so you got the difference between what is going to be your adaptation as well as acclimatization. All right, so this adaptation is what that is carrying over in a permanent mode. Yes, everyone, so this is all clear to you. Maybe you could have done it already, so we are very quickly revising into that. Yes, if you have doubts, just ping me. All right, fine. So this acclimatization is going to be the more temporary one. So I told you that on the fear of corona, you are all staying inside the home. Yes, so that is a permanent one? No, it is a temporary one. Once the fear of corona is gone, you will again go back. Yes, Shubhash, welcome to the class. So again you will go out, isn't it? So that becomes a temporary acclimatization, right? But what about the adaptation? It is going to be a very, very permanent one. Yes, permanent one, it will be genetically inherited. All right, but if it is going to be an acclimatization, it is a response to the environment. I told you, here the fear of corona is there, so you are not going outside. Okay, so that is an effect of, yes, naturally. So that is going to be this effect of your environment. Right, fine. If you take off with this adaptation, it is going to be an evolutionary process. Yes, so the organisms, it get adapted to this environment, and all that habitat, you could have studied about this beak adaptation. Yes, you could have studied about your Darwin finches. So what do these Darwin finches do? So depending upon the need, it is going to develop or adapt itself with a beak shape. All right, and then it is genetically determined, so it is given off to its offspring also. Yeah, everyone, so now you understood the difference between your adaptation and acclimatization. Yes, acclimatization. Oh yes, Smrita, welcome to the class, Smrita. Very nice to meet you all. Yes, everyone, great. So this acclimatization, it is going to be a morphological adjustment. It is a temporary adjustment, right, everyone? So I hope that you got the difference between what is this adaptation and what is this acclimatization. All right. So if you take up your adaptation, we are going to see it in two major parts. One is with the plant, right? Other one is with the animal, right? So under the plant, these xerophytes, yeah, Preeti, welcome to the class. So these xerophytes, they play a very important role. Yes, xerophytes, they get adapted themselves within your dry habitat. Yes, fine. So under the dryness only, you have two major trends. Okay, one it could be a physical dryness, other one it might be a physiological dryness. Right, right. So if you take the physiological dryness, like you know, water may be present, but it is too much salty. So the plant is not able to absorb that, isn't it? So that becomes a physiological dryness. Right. So anyhow, your plant must adapt itself to overcome such things. Right. So if you take these xerophytes, they are divided into three major types. Right. So the first type, it is called as this epimeral type. So what do you mean by this epimeral? This epimeral, they are actually not true xerophytes. Yes. So why they are not true xerophytes? Huh? They escape, isn't it? They escape the drought things, isn't it? Fine, fine. So that is why they are called as your drought escaping plants. Alright, so they are not your true xerophytes. So before the drought season is coming, it is just growing and it is escaping off itself from the drought. Right. The second category, it is the succulent. Yes, you could have come across the most common succulents. What are they? Can you state some example for succulent? Yes, cactus. Alright, your aloe vera. Yes, they are all succulents, isn't it? So they will survive and they are enduring your drought. Right. The third category is only very, very important. So they are called as your drought resistant plant. What do you mean by drought resistant? They are the non-succulent, but what do they do? Yes, Nazril. So what do? They are going to adapt themselves to the dryness. This is what is very, very important category, non-succulent plants. From there only all our PBT experiments begin. Yes, what do? We just take your drought resistant genes and we put it into some other organism and we make the total show. Alright, fine. So coming to animal part, yes, we are done with the plant adaptation. Now we are moving into your animal adaptation. Here we have two major categories. What are they? Warm-blooded animals and then cold-blooded animals. Warm-blooded animals, best example, we, isn't it? So we do not vary our temperature. We do not fluctuate our temperature. Always our temperature is maintained to be a constant. So the best example for the warm and homeothermic, it is going to be our human. Right. The next one, cold, and your poikilothermic, who is that? It is going to be those who are fluctuating. Yes, everyone. So who is fluctuating? Your insect, reptiles, fish, birds. No, they are all getting fluctuated. All right. Fine. And if you take up the other type of classification, one, they are going to produce the heat within inside, right? Okay, so they are called as your endotherms, right? The other part, they produce from outside. So they are called as the ectotherms, right everyone? So this is a very, very basic one. So shall we just refresh one more time what we have learned so far very quickly? We have seen the terms, what is going to be your adaptation, yes, and what is going to be your acclimatization. All right. So under the adaptation, we have seen about, this plant adaptation. So majorly we saw about the xerophytes. Under the xerophytes, we saw about your succulents, yes, and then non-succulent. And the first category, it is going to be your drought escaping ones. They are not true xerophytes. Yes, fine. So we all got all those things in plants. And then in animal, what is the classification we saw? Either this cold-blooded or warm-blooded. And one more, homeothermic. Yes, Sumitra, welcome to the class. Homeothermic and poikilothermic. Yes, everybody. Endotherms and ectotherms. Right, everyone? Yes, everybody. Yes, Sumitra. Yes, everyone. So this is all clear still now what we have been reading of? All right. Fine, fine. Right, everyone. So epimeral is the name for your non-xerophytic thing. Right. So let us begin with our next important category. So we are going to explore more about this polar bear. why this polar bear is regarded as the most, you know, studied organism as far as your adaptation is considered. Yes, so this bear is getting adapted. Yes, what all the adaptation it is going to rule? It is ruling the different laws of your ecology. Yes, by seeing only you can say the three basic laws of ecology, which is most frequently yes, thank you Nasril. So three major things that is coming off. One, it is your Bergman's rule. Yes, next it is going to be this Allen's rule, and one more it is going to be your Jordan's rule. All right, Goger's rule, right, Glover's rule. So these all things are now coming with respect to your polar bear. So we will just see the different rules. Okay, fine. Rule number one. Yes, so in your colder area, it is going to have a large body size. Okay, so most often students ask me, ma'am, yes, so ma'am, what is the surface is to volume ratio? So how, if I increase the size, yes, how the surface is volume ratio is coming down? Yes, if I increase the size, the surface is to volume ratio is coming down. Yes, so why it is so? Absolutely. So why it is going down? Shall we explore? Fine. So you see this first pic here, you have only one small cube. Okay, fine. You take this cube, it is having how many surfaces? It is having 6 surfaces. Got it? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Right? So you have 6 surfaces for this. And how many sides you have? Area squared side, isn't it? So one side it is having. Right? So what is the volume? It is only 1. So surfaces to volume ratio, it becomes 6. Isn't it? 6 divided by 1 is of course 6. This one is A, is clear to you now? Yes, everyone. So shall we move towards the B? Right. Now we are increase the volume. Okay. So instead of being this much small, we are making it this much big. So now what is increased? The volume is increased. So now what was happening to the surface to volume ratio? See, you have made them to be two-sided. Right, so now the side becomes 2, so the surface become area squared into surface, isn't it? So area is 2 squared, side squared into number of surface is 6, right? So there it was 1 squared into 6, so it was 6, but now it is 2 squared into 6. So what is 2 squared into 6? 4 into 6, 24. So surface becomes 24. What is the volume? Your side cube A3 is the volume, isn't it? Volume of a cube is A3, right? So what is A? A is 2, so it is 2 cube, so it becomes 8. So see, 24 by 8 becomes 3. So from 6, the surface to volume has become 3. Understood? Yes, everyone. So now you will not forget why, if you increase the size, the surface is to volume ratio is decreasing. Yes, no more doubts in this concept. Now you got it. Yes, everyone, it is clear now. This is how you have to understand, your Bergman's rule. All right. So as the size increases, yes, so that is going to help in decreasing, your total dissipation. Yes. So what happens? Actually, your volume, it is going to produce the heat. All right. Fine. But what will happen to the surface area? It is going to dissipate it. Okay. So who is going to produce the heat? It is the volume. So the volume is going to produce the heat. All right. Whereas your surface area, what it will do? It is going to dissipate the heat. That is why often it is represented as your surface to volume ratio, it should be decreased. Now the total concept is clear to you? Yes, everyone? Fine. So if you increase the size, the surfaces to volume ratio is now decreased. So you are not, you know, leaving any more heat outside. Already it is present in a, you know, very cold condition. Isn't it? Fine. Right, everybody. So let us move into this Bergman's rule. Right. So what this Bergman's rule is now telling about? Yes, what it tells? So in case of your colder climate, yes, in case of your colder climate, what happens to the size? It is much increased. You can see here the size. It is a normal bear. It is very small, isn't it? So this normal bear is too small over there. But what happens to your polar bear? It is pretty big in size as compared to your normal bear, isn't it? So why it is so? It is because of this Bergman's rule. It will be able to tolerate, you know, that much cold or warm. I mean, warmth will be generated because it has to survive in your, cold places. Got it? Yes. So what it does? So if at all it is going to be in this colder region, it is going to get bigger in size, right? So it is increasing with the latitude. Got it? Not only, you know, you might get with the latitude also. Never think that they will give you only the temperature. If they are giving this latitude also, it is going to increase the rate. Right, everyone? So this is the Bergman's rule. Yes, so if it is going to be a cooler climate, and this is applicable especially to this warm-blooded vertebrates. Okay, so this warm-blooded vertebrates, so it is going to be very, very big in size now. Got it? Very good, everybody. Fine. So the next important rule that we are going to study today, it is this Allen's rule. All right. So what this Allen's rule is telling about now? Oh yes. So this Allen's rule, it is speaking about, you know, this appendages. Okay. So have you ever, met any Eskimos? Have you ever seen Eskimo? Yes. If you have any chance, by chance, maybe in any of your National Geographical Channel or your Discovery, maybe, you know, you could have seen some of the Eskimos coming on board. Yes, if you have seen that, you could have understood that the Eskimos, they will be very, very short. Okay, as compared to us, their hands and legs, they will be very, very short. Especially the appendages are very short. Alright, why these appendages are very short for the Eskimos? Yes, this is because, you know, you can even feel that, you know, if at all you are moving into a very cold place, you will feel the chillness in your appendages. Yes, your peripheral things, for example, your hands, it will shiver. So you go for a fireplace. Yes, am I right or wrong? Yes, everyone? Why you are doing so? Always in the fireplace, why you keep your hands over there? This is because your extremities, they are going to lose heat more rapidly. Alright, so that is the reason. Why it is doing so? Because of the high surface area. Okay, so because of that only, your extremities, it is losing the heat. Right, so what does this Allen's rule state about? This states that your endotherms means they produce heat from inside. So like us, isn't it? So what do? Especially think of this Eskimos. Yes. So what do the Eskimos do? They have very short limbs. Maybe your Snow White, all your fantasy stories may be true. Yes. Why it may be true? It is all short, no? It is all Snow White, you could have read that it is all coming under your colder areas, isn't it? Maybe that may be a true story also, we don't know. But that is very well aligning with this Allen's rule, because majority of the Eskimos, they have very, very shorter appendages. The limb size, if you compare, no? And the other way around, if you compare this Negroes, yes? You could have noted that with West Indies player also. They will be very, very tall. Yes? So they have a very long limb. Why so? Because they live in a very warm region. Got it? So they want to give off more heat outside. Right? So they want to lose. So they are very, very tall. But if you take up this Eskimos, they will have very, very short limb. Why so? they want to minimize the loss. Got it? Yes. So all these ears, limb, everything, it will be very, very small in size. Yes, everyone. So this is all now done with the Allen's rule. Right, this is the best example you can see. No, this is in a warm blooded region. I mean, it is in a warmer region. Alright, so if it is in the warmer region, so what happens to the appendage? It is very long. In the colder region, the appendage just is going to be very, very short. Right, okay, see this tail is very big here. This is in a warm region. See here, the tail is very short. Why? It is in the cold region. Yes, everybody? So you got it? Yes? Huh. So this is going to be your Allen's rule. Right? So shall we just compare and contrast your Bergman's rule with the Allen's rule? Yes, everybody. Come on. So in Bergman's rule, what do we study? And in Allen's rule, what did we study? Right. So Bergman, what it is saying? It is going to be large in size. Here, the external appendages, yes, external appendages are going to be short. Where? In your cold region, isn't it? So in this warm region, what happens? This appendages, it will be long. And here it will be small in size because they want to minimize the heat loss. Yes, everyone. So this Bergman's and Allen's rule is now clear to you? All right. Yes. One more rule is there. It is this Glauger's rule. Right. So what this Glauger's rule is telling about? This Glauger's rule states that if you include your a human, what happens? The pigmentation is going to be very, very less, right? So that is the Glauger's rule. The first diagram you can see here, the pigmentation is very, very less. Why? Already it is living in a very cold area, isn't it? So the pigmentation is going to be very, very less with the Allen's rule. Sorry, with your Glauger's rule, right? And one more rule is there. It is called as your Rench rule. Okay, so this Rench rule, what it is saying is that if it is going to be from the colder area, they will have, see, this Rench rule states that you might get a match the following type of question. Okay, so Bergman's rule, it is regarding the size. Allen rule is regarding the extremity. Glauger's rule is regarding the pigmentation. Rench rule is regarding the wings, bird's wings. Got it? So bird's wing, what will happen? If it is going to be in the colder region, okay, it is going to be narrow. All right? If it is going to be in this warmer region, it is going to be very, very wide. Got it? So this is called as the Rench rule. One more rule that is called as the Jordan's rule. If it is going to be cold water, they will have more vertebra. Right? So shall we just make a quick revision now? Come on. So this Bergman's rule, it is related to what? Yes, Bergman, it is related to size. Yes. Allen's rule, it is related to appendage, isn't it? Appendage. Right. And then Glauger's rule, it is related to pigment. Come on, mark this slide for vision. Yes. Rench rule. So these birds, yes, they will have a narrow wing. Where? Whenever they are present in the cold region. All right. And one more, it is going to be this Jordan's rule. So what it says? So in the cold water, the fish, yes, Shubhashish. In cold water, the fish is going to contain more vertebra. Got it? Yes. So clip this slide, mark this slide or note this slide. It is very important. Definitely you will get a question from this. All right, everyone? Yes. Yes, Sujata. It is going to be this pigment. Very good, Sujata. Yes, Shubhashish. Yes, everybody else on board? Come on. So let us make a move into the next important one. All right. So before moving into the questions, I am just telling you about the list of courses that is available in our program. Yes, Sujata. So this CSIR NET, it is a very, very competitive exam. So greater than 2.5 lakhs applicants are making, okay, for this exam. Yes, out of the 2.5 lakh, 1000, less than 1000 at least, they are awarded with the JRF, okay. So just think of the competition. Why there is a high competition? Because after completing the JRF, you will be getting a stipend which is approximately equal to 40,000. Okay, along with that, you will get a direct registration to your PhD, right? So if you go into a private institute for the PhD, they will charge you some 3 to 5 lakhs, okay? So if you want to do it with fellowship, definitely you need JRF. Yes, this is the amount of competition. So you can make use of our Unacademy platform, for learning all those things, okay? So by April 2nd, that is tomorrow, I am beginning with a crash course, okay? So that course will go for 60 days, all right? So 10 days, first 10 days, I am beginning with the methods, a very, very important unit, right? So from tomorrow, I am beginning with that. All right, so this is the course structure. If you want to take up for 3 months, you can do it. It is coming around 5200 and odd. If you wish to go for 12 months, you can go ahead. It is going to be around 10,500. So now you have an option. You can use the referral code. Okay. So if you give this referral code, my code is SaranyaLive. Okay. Any one code you can use, and my code is SaranyaLive. If you use it, you will get 10% off on the total fees. Got it? Yes. So you will get a benefit. Now, if you are going for 10,000, you will get 1,000 rupees off. All right. Oh yes, Subhashis. Still class is there, Subhashis. I have a lot of questions until half an hour class is there. All right. Yes, very well. So if it is going to be for 3 months, then you will get 500 rupees off. Yes. This is all clear. Fine. So these are all the features that you will get. You will get PDF material. You will get, oh yes, Pankaj, thanks a lot. Still class is there. You will get, your PDF notes. You will get, the total structured courses. You will have the access towards the live quiz. You will have the access to the doubt clearance session. All right, fine. So shall we just make a move into the next important one? So by seeing this diagram, what is coming up to your mind? Yes. What this yellow bird is doing and what this red fellow is doing to you, and what has happened at last. Can you just guess? Yes, everyone, come on. Can you just guess from it? So what it is all doing? So what it is inducing? So see, initially this is going to be, probably I will just put it down. Yes, everyone, I'll pull it down, don't worry. Yeah, just a minute. I got it is hiding na. Okay, fine. Okay, so whenever it is hiding, I'll pull it down, don't worry. Alright? Oh yes, thanks for the feedback. Fine. Yes. So here what has happened, there is a competition between your red and yellow. Okay? Right. Yes. So the first thing that you can infer is, it is a nick. Okay? For this yellow bird, yes? So this total tree, it is going to be a nick. Okay, so you can call it as a fundamental nick. Okay, so because it can occupy the total tree. All right. Second, what has happened? There is a competition, isn't it? Fine. So because of this competition, what happened? This red is occupying this lower half and this yellow is occupying this upper half. Right, they are not excluded, but it is going to be a resource partition. So many terms are here, isn't it? Yes. So this is going to become a resource partition, isn't it? Now you got it? So this is becoming like a resource partition. I will take the top, you will take the bottom. So it is not excluded from the population, but it is managing with the thing, right? Fine. Yes. And now this becomes, this LO, this becomes what? It is a realized NIC. Got it? Because of the competition, this LO is now made to sit only at the top, even though it can go to the bottom also. Got it? So this becomes a realized NIC. Yes. So too many components we have revised today. What is that? Number one, it is going to be the fundamental NIC and the realized NIC. Now you understood what is the fundamental NIC, what is the realized NIC, right? Second point, it is going to be your competitive exclusion. Yes. Third point, it is going to be the resource partitioning. Yes. So everything goes hand by hand, right? Yes. So this Gauss law, it says, about this competitive exclusion. So what does it says about your competitive exclusion? One species, it is outcompeting the other species. Okay. So because of that, the second species is eliminated from that area. So it is happening or not here? Yes. See, this is eliminated from this area. You got it? So there is an occurrence of your competitive exclusion. Yes. Got it, everyone? Fine. Clear now? So you got all the concepts clear now. What is competitive exclusion? What is going to be your resource partitioning? What is the fundamental and realized NIC? So you got everything clear now, right? Come on, everyone. So the same concept of your resource partitioning, yes, it is very evergreen. It is given by your finches. Yes. Yes, this warblers. So what do they do? Resource partitioning. See, this fellow is occupying only this region. You got it? Yes. So this becomes his own area. So the total tree is being divided into subpart such that nobody is competing and eliminating the other ones. Right? So the second fellow, he is sitting only here in this yellow region. Right? Third one is only sitting at this top. Right? Fourth one, it is living in this area. Fifth one is living down. So it is going to be a resource partition, right? So it is not overlapping with each other. That is why it is able to survive, right? So now I have given a diagram. You are going to identify what is this X and what is this Y and what is this Z. Yes. So you can see two species. So this is going to be your Thalamus, right? This blue color, it is going to be Balanus. Okay, fine. So now what is this X? So there is a low tide and high tide. Yes. So this Thalamus fellow is surviving in both these area. So what this is called? What this is called? What nick it is? Yes. So what nick it is for your Thalamus? Come on, think and tell me. It is surviving in both of your high tide and low tide. Okay. So what nick it is going to be? So this is going to be your nothing. Fundamental nick. Yes, yes, it is the fundamental nick. Because it is surviving in the total area. Okay. So now what this is? Yes, yes, Vaishali. So this is going to become your realized nick for whom? For this Thalamus. Got it? Fine. So now here who is coming? Your Balanus is coming. Okay. So this Balanus realized nick is this region. Okay. You got it? Yes. This is going to be this Balanus realized nick. This is going to be your Thalamus realized nick. This is going to be your Thalamus fundamental nick. Clear, everyone? Yes. So now you are clear in all those concepts. These are all frequently asked for, right? So now shall we take up your PYQ? Yes, such that you will understand this concept better, right? Okay, fine. So this following are the nick characteristics. I'm just reading out. So this is going to be your nick characteristics. Okay, fine. So of your resource partitioning, just now we saw about your resource partitioning. All right, fine. So now, which is going to lead to your competitive exclusion? All right. So which is going to lead to your competitive exclusion? Yes. See this number one, it is showing an overlap and then some reminder is there. Here it is, both the things are 100% overlapping. Okay, here also this overlap is there. Right, here also no, a little bit of overlap is there. Fine, so which is going to be competitively excluding each other? Apply your Gauss law. Yes, which is the answer then? Which will totally exclude? So when the fight will be maximum? Yes. It is going to be your option B. Yes, everyone. Why B? See, the two organisms are 100% overlapping with each other. So, no two species will coexist. Yes? No two species will coexist. Yes, Sujata. Yes, absolutely. Yes, Shubhashish. So, no two species will coexist. So, if it is going to be 100% overlap, definitely it is going to lead to exclusion. So, what will happen here? Yes, this A will live here, B will live here. So, in this bridge, nobody will come. Okay, because it is going to be a competition, isn't it? So, it will survive. So, it is not going to get excluded. Here also, this reminder region is there. So, in that they will survive. But here only it is 100% overlapping with each other. So if there is going to be an overlap, no two species will coexist. So both of them will fight and try to exclude each other. Got it? Clear? Done? Okay. So you can see two images. What are the laws you can apply for this? Yes. A and B. Come on. A, which law is coming to your mind? Yes. For A, which law, A and B, which laws are coming to your mind? Quick. For A and B, which laws you are just thinking of? Come on. Very quick. We have a lot to revise today. All the rules are applicable. Bergman, Y, size. Yes, it is very thin. This is very fat. Bergman. Right? What about Allen? Yes, why Alan? Yes, everybody. Yes, Dara, welcome to the class. Yes, Vaishali, Sujata, very good. Yes, you see here very big. Here is very, very short. Yes, and then what about your gloggers? It is very fair. This is so all the rules are applicable, isn't it? Right, it was just for a summary. Okay, so a general increase in this average body mass within a within the latitude. Okay, oh yes, Akash, I am very fine. Akash, how do you do? Yes, Akash, very nice to meet you back. Come on, so a general increase, yes, in the body mass is directly related with the Bergman's rule. Yes, no doubt it is going to be your Bergman's rule. It is a PYQ, okay, part B question. This is also PYQ, another part B, 2 marks. Come on. So, individuals with greater mass, they will have smaller surface area. Yes, Akash, smaller surface area to volume ratio. Yes, so what this is known as? Yes, if it is having a greater mass, it have your smaller Surface is to volume ratio. So what it is known as? Again, your Bergman's rule only, isn't it? Yeah, that is what we are seeing in detail. Right? So if it is going to contain your greater mass and your yes, so it is going to be your Bergman's rule. Alright, fine. Yes, everyone. So the next important concept that we are going to revise is your island biogeography. Yes, Shubhashish. Yes, Dara. Yes, everyone. Very good, Vaishali, Akash. Yes, Shubhashish and Sujata. Very good. So the next important thing that is lazy. So very important thing, it is going to be your Bergman's, right? D. Okay. So the next thing that we are going to see, it is about your island biogeography. Alright, fine. So in island biogeography, I will very briefly tell you only two things. Yes, number one, it is related, yes, with a size. Okay, so that you call as area. Okay, fine. So if this area it is going to be large, it will have greater species richness. Okay, Yashwati. So if it is going to be very, very small, all right, fine. So if it is going to be very, very small, then what will happen to the species richness? It is going to decrease. Okay, so that is going to be the main mechanism that is going to correlate between these two, right? Fine. So this is a really very, very important rule. All right, fine. So if your size of the area is very big, that means that it is going to lead to the increased species richness. Yes, fine, yeah. Absolutely. So, yes. Oh, yes, very well. So, the next point that we have to understand, it is going to be the distance from the mainland. All right, fine. So, if it is going to be very, very near, right? So, if it is going to be very, very near, then what happens? So, you will get, Akash. No, it is a revision session only, Akash. Yes, everybody. Fine. So, it is a revision session. Oh, yes. Come on, it is a revision session. All right, fine. So, I was telling about, the distance from your mainland. If the distance, it is going to be very, very near, right? So, you will get a variety of species richness. All right. But if the distance is going to be little bit far away, then what you will get? You will get less number of species richness. See, yeah. So, I have got one more question regarding this Cope's rule. So, Cope's rule is regarding the fossil fuel. Okay, so this is not regarding the living one. So, remember the Cope's, it is also dealing with the size, right? But that Cope's is with related to the fossil. Okay, so it is not related to the living organism. Okay, so this is going to conserve the heat. Okay, so that means that it is a living one. So, if it is living, you can rule out the Cope's rule. Got it? Yes, Ashwati. Yes, everybody else? So, you are a little bit confused with this B, no? Yeah, why we are eliminating B is that B, it is especially with the evolution and it is more talking about this fossil determination, okay? So, it is not with the living organisms. Alright, fine. So, coming back here, so I was telling you about your island size and then the distance. These two are the major ones. If your island is going to be an empty land, then what will happen? So, everything is related to your unit, okay, per unit area, right? So, what do you mean by per unit area? See, in your total college, you might have some 3000 students, all right? Per class, you might have a strength of 16. Per class, you might have a strength of 30, okay? It varies, but each class is going to have some numbers. Okay, so that is going to become your per unit number. Fine. So you imagine a college is newly opened. Fine. Yes. So this college is newly opened. So no more advertisement. So what will happen? They will welcome every student inside. Am I right? If it is an empty college, they are going to welcome everybody inside. So there is going to be a very, very low competition. right? And you know, there will be very high immigration. Many students will be coming inside and they will not allow you to go outside. They will treat you like a queen or king. Yes, they will not allow you to exit from that institute if it is going to be an empty land, right? Fine. But see, if it is going to be a very, very popular college, okay, so it is having only 30 seats. So what they will do? They will create a very big competition. Yes, we do have a very stringent entrance test. Yes, so we will make very, very low immigration. Yes, even if you exit the college after your BSc also, they don't care about. Why? It is a very popular one. Anyhow, it knows that you will be getting. Oh yes, Shubhashis, because here the number is more. We are not bothered like whether if you are exiting or not. Right. So here it is going to have a high extension rate and a low immigration. Why? Already we have a batch of ready students. You got it? So out of this 30, already this 25 seats will be filled. Okay. So this next 5 only it will come inside. Okay. Already they have fixed it. You got it? Right. So this is the difference between your empty land and then this populated land. If it is going to be an empty land, you are being welcomed. But if it is with a high competition, then you should only survive with that. So now this is all clear to you. If it is going to be a near land, there will be high immigration. If there is a far land, it is going to be a low immigration. Got it? Fine. So shall we solve a couple of questions? Yes, Akash, your questions are here now. Right, everybody. Yes, Shubhashis. Yes, Dara, Vaishali. Yes, Sujata. Who else on board? Come on, everybody else. Yeah, Lazy. Oh, yes, everybody. Different names. Right. Okay, everyone. Come on. So, let us take up this question for the day. So, which one of the following is not a prediction? Okay. Out of your Wilson Markarthur's theory. Yes. So this number of the species, it is going to increase with the size. Yes, I told you, your species richness is proportional to the area. So this is right. This is not true. Okay, so this is not true. Right. The number of species, it will decrease with the increasing distance from the island. Yeah. So the species richness is inversely proportional to the distance. So this is also true. The turnover is going to be common. I told you, no, you will be coming inside, you will be going outside. That is what is called as turnover. That is going to not make a big deal. It is very, very common. See, this is going to be the wrong answer. What it says, the species richness, it is related to the average distance from the neighboring island. Not the neighboring island. It depends only from the mainland. No way this Mark Arthur has mentioned about the neighbor. Got it? Yes, everyone? So is this question clear to you? We will make up a move towards the next point. Yes or no? Come on, everyone. Cheer up, cheer up. Yes? Done? All right. Fine, everybody. So let us make a move towards the next question. So this is also from your Mark Wilson and Arthur, right? So this equilibrium model of your this island biogeography, so that was proposed by Arthur and Wilson. Yes, Shubhashis. So it is telling about what? Yes, which one? So this is telling about your yes, it is telling about your colonization rate and the extinction rate. Got it? Fine. So coming to this. Yes. So shall we solve this? Is it already done or new to? Yes. So here what it is happening with this? If you take up a forest. Yeah, Shubhashis, come on. So it is going to be an agricultural land. Okay. Fine. So this agricultural land, what is going to happen of? Come on. Yes, Sajata. So in this agricultural land, you are going to apply your Mark Arthur principle. Number one, it is about this area. So if it is about this area, what will happen to the species richness? I told you it is directly proportional. If you increase the area, the species richness should also increase. So within this A or B, which is going to be correct? See, this is 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. What about this? 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. If you increase this 10, this becomes 20. If you increase this to be 30, this becomes 40. Yes? So when you increase the fragment area, the species richness is increasing. So A is true. You got it? Yes, everyone? So A is true. You got it? Yes? Fine. So what about here? It says that the species richness and fragment is inversely proportional. Wrong. Yes, everybody? So why this is wrong? See, if you increase this area to 50, what happened to the species richness? It is decreasing to 10, right? So this is absolutely a wrong statement. You got it, everyone? Yes. So what about, you know, your distance? Yes, what is the formula for the distance? Distance and species richness are inversely proportional. That means if you increase the distance, the species richness should decrease. So CRD, which is going to be correct? Yes? CRD, which is going to be correct? Come on, everyone. Yes, yes, C or D, which is going to be correct? See, if you increase, this is increasing, isn't it? So this is wrong. This is only going to be correct. If you increase the distance, the species richness is going to decrease. Option B, you couldn't understand. Yes, Subhashis, I will tell you. So A and D, that is going to be your option B is the correct answer. Yes, yes. Yes, Subhashis. So I will tell you about, you know, what is wrong with this B. Okay. Yes. Just a minute. Yeah, yeah. Just a minute. I will erase and show you one more time. Yes. Okay. Yes. So see here. This is about your species richness. Okay. So this is about the species richness. Okay, so this is about your area, right? Fine. So you see here, you increase this area from 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. Okay, so here what happened to the species richness? When this is 10, the species richness is 100. You got it? So when this fragment area is 10, the species richness is 100 as per this graph. Alright, so if the species richness is 90, this area is becoming 20. So this is directly proportional or this is indirectly proportional? You got it? So as per this B graph, as this fragment area increases, the species richness is decreasing. You got it? This is absolutely wrong. If you increase your area, the species richness should increase. Yes? So now you understand, everyone? Your area is directly proportional to your species richness. Now you got it, everyone? And your distance, yes, it is inversely proportional to the species richness. Fine. So, if it is going to be very, very near, it will be rich. See, this is 10. So, here it is getting 100. Yes, yes. So, this is becoming, no, the nearest one. That is why it is showing a maximum, because it is inversely proportional. But here it is directly proportional. So, only this becomes the answer. Oh, yes, everyone. So, I guess that this is all clear to you. So shall we just take up, no, one more question? Shall we do this? Yes, since because it is a revision, you know, I thought that we will put it. Yes, so shall we solve this or shall we take this this question? This is very interesting and, you know, it is directly with a graphical question. So for all these graphical questions, I will just tell you, kindly note down the points, okay? So where you have to note down, because many of the students told that they have this scroll option. Okay, so when you are seeing, you will be getting the questions in part. Okay, so you cannot read that full question in a single go. So what you can do, you can make down points in your rough section such that you will be able to get the total meaning out of it. Okay, fine. So let us take this question and end the class. All right. So these antelopes, they are proposed to form the groups, okay, to reduce the risk of predation. So a researcher, he measured the predation of individuals of different sizes. So she found that this mortality risk, okay, so this mortality risk, what happened to the mortality risk? It decreased. See, this mortality rate, it is decreased when with the increasing group size for male. Okay, for males, if you increase the group size, this mortality, it is getting decreased, right? But it is unchanged for whom? For female. Oh yes. Oh yes, yes, Deep Raj, definitely. Okay, so you want to do it on your charges, isn't it? Oh yes, definitely, Deep Raj. I will make a session for you. Don't worry, I will definitely plan a session for this. Yes, and we will solve this question in a separate session only. Don't worry, I will teach you how to solve it, right? All right, because the time is getting to end, so you will complete this question before. Yes, Deep Raj, definitely I will solve the question in a separate session, right? Oh yes, so this is going to become unchanged for female. Okay, so male, it is going to be represented as a solid lion. So female, it is going to be this lion. Okay, dotted lion. All right. Next, the male, it should have greater per capita mortality compared to the female. So what should happen? Oh yes, Deep Raj, definitely we will do. So this male, it should contain no greater mortality risk than the female. That means the male line should be above the female's one. Got it? Fine. So you can see the option. You can just tell me which is going to be the correct answer for this question. Yes. So you have seen 2 points. One, what is that? One, yes, male. This mortality, what has happened? And with the female, what are the two rules? So I told you that always this male is greater than the female. Yes. And then female, it is going to be unchanged. Yes, absolutely. Your D is the correct answer. So simple, no? For 4 marks. This is why, you know, we always choose. Yes, Siranjeev Singh. Yes, Vaishali. Very good. It is a very, very simple one. Only thing you have to first read the question. You got it, everybody? Right? Yeah. So this is how your questions are being asked from the graphical part. So under graphical thing, you need not do anything. Just read and understand the question fully with patience. You will get it. Right? All right, everybody. So this is a set of information for you. So all these are my students who have already cracked up the examination. All right, very good. So like this, I definitely want you to crack up your exams, right? So if at all, you know, you have not yet subscribed for our thing, so go for the subscription. You can use my code BIOVSC, you can use my code SaranyaLive. So you will get a 10% off on the total fees, right? All right, everyone, I will see you in my class probably. Yes, from tomorrow I am making a crash revision course for 60 days. Yes, it is the last one, right? For 60 days I am planning a crash course. All right, everybody, so plan to join. All the very best. I'll catch you up soon. Bye bye, take care, and all the best. Yes, everyone, bye bye, take care. Good night.